Welcome, everybody. My name is Tegert Schamke, and I'm professor for agroecology at the University of Göttingen in Germany. Research in our group focuses on biodiversity patterns and associated ecosystem functioning at different spatial and temporal scales and in managed and natural systems. Field studies are based in tropical and temperate regions, comparing food webs and multitrophic interactions, but we are also interested in multidisciplinary studies linking socioeconomic with ecological approaches. In the following, I introduce concepts on how to integrate biodiversity and associated ecosystem services in agriculture. I illustrate ideas mostly with published results of our agroecology research group. We face globally conflicting challenges. On the one hand, we live in the UN decade on biodiversity and should follow the approved strategies to halt biodiversity losses. On the other hand, 1 in 9 people in the world are food insecure, and the global food demand has been estimated to double until 2050 because of the growing population and the dietary changes, such as eating more protein. This is a pretty conflicting challenge, as agriculture is still the main cause of biodiversity losses, so agricultural intensification for more food should further reduce biodiversity. There has been already a UN and EU biodiversity strategy to 2010, which completely failed. No success in halting biodiversity decline, no restoring of endangered ecosystems so far. The same failure can be expected for the 2020 targets. In Germany, a recent report pointed to this dramatic situation, as biodiversity losses are currently still ongoing, although in Germany, almost all pristine natural ecosystems have vanished already decades ago. Still, 1/3 of the 270 arable wheat species are endangered, 41% of the 560 bee species are endangered, 30 to 70% of hoverflies show declines even in the last 20 years, from 1989 to 2014. And 50% of the common farmland bird species exhibit population declines currently in the last 20 years. 65% of ecosystem types have disappeared in most landscapes. Integrating biodiversity in agriculture needs a management adapted to spatial scale, as requirements change from the level of local plants, fields or farms to landscape and global scales. Farmers and conservationists are typically interested only in the local scale, where management takes place. This is the plant and field level. The same applies for the agro-environmental EU policy that are also interested at the local scale only. However, key drivers of local patterns and processes are determined at the landscape scale, by the available pool of populations and species in the landscape. I will come back to this important aspect in the following. This presentation is subdivided in 3 parts, each dealing with a distinct spatial scale. At the local scale, my focus is on agricultural practices integrating biodiversity and associated services for sustainable agroecosystems. At the landscape scale, landscape composition and configuration should be designed to enhance habitat connectivity and to combine the so-called land-sparing strategy, that is, setting aside land spared for nature, with a land-sharing strategy, that means agricultural production with biodiversity-friendly farming practices. And at the global scale, national governance plays a major role, and I focus on the importance of adapted solutions for smallholders. I start with local management for biodiversity services, and below you see a photo of a polyculture of barley with pea. Decisions on local management in family farms, which make up 98% of all farms globally, is mainly driven by socioeconomic thinking to make the best out of their farm. Agroecological intensification aims at reducing hostility of agroecosystems to biodiversity and associated services, which contributes to the resilience of agroecosystems under changing environments. The following recommendations can be given. Implement crop diversification, but more research on how to identify best crop combinations is needed. Reduce fertilizer applications, as only compensation of nutrient losses is justified, while legumes may become part of crop rotation. Reduce pesticide applications, which is already facilitated by crop diversification and reduced N applications. Further, measures to enhance natural enemies include weedy agriculture and refuge habitats in the surrounding of the crop field. Consider fallows with natural succession of native plants to allow survival of functionally important biodiversity. Cap yield peaks with adapted resilient varieties, replacing vulnerable high-yielding varieties. And maintain or restore small fields with field boundaries as refuges of functional biodiversity and for habitat connectivity across landscapes. Crop pollination is a major ecosystem service provided mainly by bees. This is why measures to maintain or restore pollinator populations are such important. Pollination improves agricultural production of 75% of the 115 most important crops globally, influencing a third of global human food supply. And the annual monetary value of global pollination services has been estimated to be 235 to 577 billion US dollar. This is in contrast to the current pollinator crisis, as 40% of invertebrate pollinators face extinction these days. Crop pollination does not only enhance yields, but also fruit quality, which has been recently shown for strawberries. Well-pollinated strawberries are brighter with more red color, and the higher acid-sugar ratio shapes the taste. In particular, strawberries become firmer and have a longer shelf life, so decay takes several days longer, which is the most important aspect for marketing. All in all, well-pollinated strawberries yield 39 to 53% more. Here are a few more details for a better understanding of pollination services in agriculture. In a comprehensive global analysis, Lucas Garibaldi has shown that wild insects, in particular bees, are much more efficient pollinators than honeybees, and wild bees, not honeybees, drive yield in most crops. However, crops are pollinated mainly by common bee species, as more than 85% of all bee species have never been observed on crops. Conservation of these majority of bee species need extra attention. Nevertheless, effective pollination needs several species. Jochen Fründ has experimentally shown with the exclusion cages shown here in the photo that increasing species and functional traits enhances pollination success. He also showed with climate chambers that response diversity of bees play a major role in hibernation. Higher winter temperatures did shorten time of development during hibernation, as you might expect, but only for some bee species, whereas other bee species experience an unexpected delay in their development with higher temperature. Higher richness of pollinating bees can also be more important than higher abundance. This has been shown for Highland coffee. The number of bee species declines with distance to forests where plenty of nesting resources can be found. As a result, coffee yields only 55% of the potential yield at 1500 meter distance to the nearest forest patch. Similarly, pollination of pumpkin is enhanced by bee richness, not simply by the frequency of flower visitation. Here, the number of bee guilds provided an even better explanation than bee richness. Body size, time, and height of flower visited were the traits of the bee species that were important for complementary resource use of flowers and overall pollination success. Like crop pollination, biological pest control by natural enemies belongs to the little appreciated background services provided by ecosystems for free. Without any specific biocontrol measures, our cereal fields, for example, harbor hundreds of thousands of spiders and hundreds of thousands of predatory beetles, exhibiting great power in reducing pest population densities. Here, I refer to a multi-author study on the biological control of cereal aphids across Europe. Plastic barriers on the ground and wire mesh, as you can see on the photo, was used to selectively exclude ground-dwelling or vegetation-dwelling predators and parasitoids. Here also drawings of an aphid parasitoid, a ladybird beetle, and a ground beetle. We found that excluding all enemies triplicated the number of cereal aphids. Further, both the ground-dwelling spiders and the beetles, as well as the vegetation-dwelling hoverflies, ladybird beetles, and parasitoids, contributed to aphid control in a complementary manner. And across European regions, different enemy groups were most important. For example, parasitoids were most important in Poland, but ground beetles most important in Sweden. This reveals functional redundancy. These results show how important it is to have many different species of predators as an important insurance under changing environments. In the tropics, biological pest control is much more important for sustaining yields than in temperate regions. In Indonesian cacao agroforestry, we showed that the native ant community, which is diverse and evenly distributed, contributes to 27 to 34% of cacao yield. Similarly, bird and bat exclusion reduced 31% of cacao yield, showing the great importance of maintaining insectivorous birds and bats close to the cropland. Diversification of cropland is a major measure to enhance biological pest control and the overall stability of crop production. Letourneau provides a meta-analysis showing that crop diversification is reducing herbivore density and reducing herbivore damage of crops while enhancing the density of natural enemies. This clear effect does unfortunately not translate into yield increases, which is often due to reduced crop density, resource competition, and reduced crop quality in diversified systems. This review identifies an important weakness in agroecological intensification. Crop diversification is definitely very important for resilient cropland, but more research is needed to identify optimal combinations of crops for sustainably promoting yields. It is all about combining the right plant species in space and time to guarantee a complementary resource use and interplant facilitation. However, almost all research money is invested in conventional agriculture, not in optimizing agroecological biodiversity-friendly systems. To illustrate the importance of cropland diversification, I give a few examples. In China, high genetic diversity of rice varieties have been shown to reduce the infestation level of a major pathogen and thereby to greatly increase yield over large areas. In Europe, multi-resistant wheat cultivars have been shown to allow reduced fungicide use and can be profitable despite minor yield losses. But farmers stuck in their traditional focus on high-yielding varieties were reluctant to adopt this strategy. However, highest yield is often not the best strategy to maximize net revenues and to reduce risks. The last example is a famous push-pull strategy for natural control of maize pest, first introduced in Kenya, but meanwhile adopted in many countries and many crops. This successful strategy to reduce pest problems and sustain yields works with repellent plants inside cropland, pushing pests away, and with trap plants surrounding the cropland, pulling pests outside the crop. In an EU-wide project, we quantified how agricultural intensification, measured as crop yield, is related to biodiversity. These studies were carried out across 9 European regions and focused on altogether 1,350 winter wheat fields. As expected, and as you can see on the left, richness of plant species was negatively related to wheat yield. Doubling yield means the loss of half of all species. Such a negative relationship was also found in this study for carabid beetles and for birds, as well as for biological pest control. We asked for the mechanistic reason of this relationship and tested 13 local and 9 landscape variables. The level of pesticide applications, so the level of herbicide, insecticide, and fungicide applications, this turned out to be the most important consistent signal explaining these dramatic reductions in biodiversity. Pesticides appear to be also indirectly affect biodiversity through changes in resource availability and in below and above ground interactions. Negative externalities or side effects of pesticides are well known. Coating of seeds from oilseed rape, maize or sunflower with neonicotinoids or neonics is common practice but has nothing to do with integrated pest management, as these systemic insecticides are applied a priori, which means without field estimates whether pest densities are above an economic threshold level. Further, these neonics can accumulate in the soil and affect soil organisms and their contribution to soil fertility. Neonics or neonicotinoids are toxic insecticides that affect homing ability of honeybees. That is, high percentages of honeybee workers do not find back to their colony. In addition, bumblebees produce only few queens for the following year. And also the survival of other wild bees and their pollination success is reduced. Overall, insect mortality induced by these pesticides also means less resources for birds, in particular farmland birds, which suffer from great declines currently. Beyond the traditionally measured lethal doses or the lethal concentration for 50% mortality, the sublethal exposure to pesticides plays a major role. These sublethal indirect effects of pesticides change reproduction, change behavior, and change the vitality of all kinds of beneficial insects. The sublethal pesticide exposure also affects footweb interactions, which is ecologically a disaster. Below, I show 2 examples of such bipartite but still complex interaction webs which we found. Nitrogen applications on cropland and grassland cause important negative externalities, which are often neglected. Part of the problem is the low eco-efficiency in agriculture. Efficiency is the level of output divided by the level of input, also called the input-output risk. With respect to nitrogen fertilization, sevenfold increase in nitrogen application between 1960 and 1995 was related to doubling yields. Hence, efficiency declined from 70 kilograin to 25 kilograin per kilogram nitrogen applied. Over-fertilization is a great problem in Europe, also in Germany, with on average 100 kilogram nitrogen applied by one hand per hectare instead of 80 kilogram. This is an even greater problem in countries such as China and in stark contrast to the problem of under-fertilization in sub-Saharan Africa. Africa agriculture is heavily contributing to climate change with 30 to 35% of global greenhouse gas emissions. Taking all together, the environmental costs of all nitrogen losses in Europe are extreme, ranging from 70 to 320 billion euros per year due to water, soil and air pollution, and in particular, nitrogen pollutions affecting human health and mortality. These negative externalities of nitrogen losses outweigh the direct economic benefits of nitrogen in agriculture, according to the European Nitrogen Assessment Report. So far, I focused on agricultural fields and farms, the local level of integrating biodiversity services in agriculture. In the following slides, I introduce a few aspects of how to design total landscapes with the objective to combine land sparing with land sharing and functional connectivity. And the graphic shows here a digitized landscape in our region. We often analyze how the landscape surrounding a defined land use system affects local biodiversity patterns and processes. Decisions about how to design landscapes require participatory approaches, engaging with all stakeholders at the village level and acknowledging regional authorities and land rights. Restoring or maintaining biodiversity services in agricultural landscapes need a focus on configurational and compositional heterogeneity, which allows spillover across crops, crop boundaries, and natural habitat. The great importance of landscape design for biodiversity services has so far been neglected by EU policies and also in crop certification, which are all just locally oriented. 20% of semi-natural habitat per agricultural landscape would be a great step forward towards sustaining large species pools, biodiversity services, and connectivity among populations. Community composition substantially changes between different habitats in a given landscape. Hence, agri-environmental and conservation schemes need to focus on all landscape elements, not just one local piece. Effective strategies to maintain or restore biodiversity and associated services must have a landscape perspective on community turnover, the so-called better diversity. In contrast to common sense, managing simplified landscapes is much more efficient than managing complex landscapes, as complex landscapes harbor already so much structural heterogeneity and biodiversity that local improvements do not matter. On the other hand, totally cleared landscapes do not support any meaningful biodiversity anymore. In such a situation of impoverished species pools, local management must be also unsuccessful. The high efficiency of management in simple but not complex or cleared landscapes is addressed by the intermediate landscape complexity hypothesis. Here, landscape design is illustrated that considers both habitats spared for nature conservation and habitats shared for production and biodiversity services. Box 1 and box 2 emphasize that both the remnants of natural habitats and crop boundaries provide biodiversity that spill over to agroecosystems providing ecosystem services. Box 3 makes clear that such spillover enhanced by landscape connectivity benefits all parts of the landscape, the natural habitat, the crop boundaries, and the cropland. The box on the bottom refers to biodiversity services for crops which are provided by mainly common species. In contrast, conservation of biodiversity, that is, of the rare half of all species, needs protected reserves embedded in the connectivity matrix. Here again, I would like to emphasize the significance of functional connectivity on the landscape scale. Levin's classic metapopulation model is based on just two parameters, the extinction rate and the colonization rate. Hence, in landscapes without spillover across habitats, extinction is a dominant process, and this applies also for large reserves. If colonization is missing, only extinction plays a role. In our agricultural landscapes in Germany, narrow grass strips adjacent to crop fields are very common. Here is an example shown in the photo. Even such inconspicuous linear elements may promote movement that counteracts extinction probability. This has been shown by Andrea Holzschuh for predatory wasps dispersing from forest margins far into the landscape along these grass strips. Such grassy field margin strips can be very important for biological pest control. In oilseed rape or canola, pollen beetles feed on the flowers, thereby preventing pod development, which can be quantified by these small podless stalks, as you can see on the painting. Among the natural enemies of pollen beetles, specific parasitoids are most important. These parasitoids hibernate in the soil, so they experience high mortality when the crop field is plowed. This is why they need perennial habitat to build up large populations. The parasitoids hibernate in the field margin and then spill over into the rape field and cause then high mortality of the pollen beetle. Parasitoids induced mortality of the pollen beetle is enhanced by field margin, but even higher when large fallows are neighboring. Based on this pattern, we tested with experimental rape patches how important landscape complexity is, that is, how important a high percentage of semi-natural habitat in the landscape is. As you can see in the figure on the bottom, increasing non-crop area in the landscape, this is a higher landscape complexity, causes much higher parasitism. And in the figure on top, you can see that higher landscape complexity is also related to much reduced crop damage, that is, fewer rape pods are produced. This pattern allows the conclusion that complex landscapes with high percentage of semi-natural habitat benefits from efficient biological pest control and low pest damage. Higher complexity of landscapes increase parasitism of rape pests, but there is a difference between the field center and the field edge, which is shown here with a dashed line. The field edge. In simple landscapes, parasitism is much higher in the edge than in the center, whereas in complex landscapes, both the edge and the center experience high parasitism rates. Accordingly, if you want to manage something, the implementing of grassy field margin strips is only effective in simple landscapes. This is in support of the intermediate landscape complexity hypothesis, which I mentioned before. Cultural ecosystem services and agricultural landscapes are also based on biodiversity. The structure and biodiversity of our landscapes provide a sense of place and are part of our cultural identity. This highly appreciated biodiversity is mainly made up by species that are traditionally associated with land use. Species here in Central Europe include hares, hamsters, and the white stork, which are all meanwhile endangered by agricultural intensification. I mentioned already the high level of red-listed arable weeds, which are even immortalized on stems. Similarly, even common farmland birds such as yellowhammer, tree sparrow, or skylark, which are shown here, suffer from heavy population declines. And people love their countryside biodiversity beyond any neoliberal monetary evaluation. Conservation in our agricultural landscapes should not be driven by putting monetary values on biodiversity. Biodiversity has an ethic and cultural historic value, just as our ancient buildings and memorials. Neglecting this cultural value is simply vandalism. At a global scale, integrating biodiversity services in agriculture needs concepts that are different from what I discussed so far for the local and landscape level. Whether we find adapted solutions for smallholders is primarily decided at the national governance level. The main problem is a huge north-south difference in wealth, including differences in opportunities, in governance, and in competitive abilities at food markets. In any case, we need to focus on smallholders, as 90% of all farms globally have less than 2 hectares of land. Smallholders are the backbone of global food security, not the Western-style large-scale farms. Smallholders belong to the 98% of all farms globally that are family farms, cultivating 53% of all agricultural land. Coming back to what I introduced in the very beginning, many people claim to find trade-offs between food demands and biodiversity conservation. However, we may challenge the assumptions underlying the predicted food demand. We should be aware of the fact that current global calorie production is far more than sufficient to feed the world. But these calories, these food items, are not available to the hungry, as they simply cannot afford them. They are too poor. These people are too poor. This is in strange contrast to the currently 1.9 billion overweight people. Food usage is inefficient. 30 to 50% of food production is wasted and 30 to 50% fed to livestock. Food waste occurs in rich countries at the retailer and consumer level and in poor countries at the post-harvest level, often due to storage pests. Food waste due to livestock feeding depends on the meat type. On average, 7 calories are lost for 1 calorie of meat, but eating chicken is almost vegetarian style, as only 2 or 3 calories are needed for 1 calorie of meat. In addition, we face a biofuel hype, wasting food for energy, and land grabbing in many poor countries, violating land rights of indigenous populations, and last not least, negative effects of speculation on food commodities. Adapted solutions for smallholders imply the need to enhance biodiversity services, sustaining resilient agroecological production. Biodiversity services should contribute to reducing vulnerability to social, economic, and ecological shocks. Biodiversity services allow better biological pest control, better crop pollination, better erosion control, and higher soil fertility. If pesticides and mineral fertilizers are avoided, certification of organic farming may be an option, as organic farmers make, at least currently, significantly more money than conventional farmers on a global scale. In short, we need to advance small and adapted farms, balancing ecological and economic needs, including education and health services, as well as measures for gender equality. In my opinion, we have a global responsibility for the poor and hungry. This is why smallholders need to be supported by small-scale measures as offered by several international NGOs such as Welthungerhilfe and Plan International. Last but not least, I want to shortly introduce a collaborative study showing that high crop yield in smallholder farms can be combined with high biodiversity. Jan Klaff and co-workers analyzed in Indonesia how cacao yield, here on the x-axis, and species richness, here on the y-axis, are related. As you can see, there is no relationship in trees, fungi, butterflies, ants, spiders, birds, rats, amphibians, and reptiles. Only the herbaceous pantropical weeds show the normally expected negative relationship. This means that these agroecosystems offer much room for intensification without compromising biodiversity. In Indonesia and many other tropical regions, cacao farmers tend to cut the shade trees because they expect higher yield under full sun. However, shade trees are important to maintain biodiversity and its services in the system. Here, the left figure shows how shade tree cover given on the x-axis is related to cacao yield given on the y-axis. The solid line is adapted to field data and exhibits a clear negative relationship. However, the maximum cacao yield values are non-linearly related to shade. These maximum values follow exactly the prediction of how shade affects yield that is published as a sucrose cacao model. Interestingly, these dashed lines following the maximum yield and the model prediction demonstrates that up to 40% canopy cover, only marginal yield losses occur. This means that farmers lose almost no yield but gain a lot in terms of beneficial biodiversity if they keep up to 40% of their canopy cover. So far, I talked about shade quantity. In the right figure, the focus is on shade quality. As you can see under B, partitioning the effects of shade on yield shows that yield is mainly determined by shade tree cover and only marginally by the number of tall trees or the number of tree species. However, under C, the effects on bird richness are given. For birds, the number of tall trees and the number of forest tree species become much more important. In conclusion, restricting levels of canopy cover to 40% and diversifying shade trees is a measure that combines high yield with high bird diversity. As I have shown before, insectivorous birds together with bats are important biocontrol agents and can raise cacao yields by 31%, so keeping these birds in the system is very important. In conclusion, these results suggest that it is possible to improve both the yield and biodiversity at the same time, as illustrated here by the red lines. In addition to a diversity of tall shade trees, keeping litter and herbs in cacao agroforestry allows higher biodiversity without compromising yields. Measures promoting crop yield and biodiversity at the same time should be particularly interesting in the tropics, as yield gaps are high. Achieved yields in tropical countries are usually far below 50% of what could be achieved, so there are great opportunity for biodiversity-friendly intensification. In contrast, the yield levels in Western countries are often close to the possible maximum, over 80%, so that there is typically less room for an intensification that combines yield with biodiversity. Finding trade-offs or even synergies between yield and biodiversity is a major challenge. The red curve shows the typical situation in Western cereal fields. The green curve illustrates the opportunity in tropical countries, with their often low management efficiency and large yield gaps. But we need locally adapted agroecological solutions with practices that are promoting agriculture along the green line. Such measures include landscape diversification of crops and habitat types, both spatially and temporally, and socioeconomic features that need to be promoted include risk management, reducing household vulnerability, and considering regional traditions. Here, a short summary of how to integrate biodiversity services in agriculture are given. First, consider the scale mismatch in agricultural management. From economic thinking, households, and consensus-oriented villages to global competition at the national governance level. From local land use practices and landscape species pools to evolutionary patterns on a global scale, better diversity of endemic species. Second, on the local scale, develop effective crop diversification in small fields while minimizing agrochemical input and external costs. Third, on the landscape scale, combine land sharing with land sparing in the connectivity matrix with 20% habitat, enhancing pollination and biocontrol. Fourth, on the global scale, focus on adapted small-scale solutions for smallholders. Fifth, identify ecological, economic trade-offs with agroecological intensification to reduce household vulnerability and biodiversity loss. Thank you very much for your attention.